And good evening and welcome to another LUA Radio Special Edition. Today is May 20th, 2016, about 7:30 p.m. Central Standard Time here in the communist state of Illinois, and also there in Texas. How are you doing this evening, Kyle?
Not too bad, not too bad. Yourself?
I can't complain at all, can't complain at all. I was really surprised we were able to actually do this LUA Radio Special Edition tonight. I've had internet connection issues for the past 24 hours or so, as you're very keen to, so... yeah, glad we are able to get this out this evening. So, and Kyle is with thelastbastille.com. That's his blog. Make sure, definitely go check it out. A couple of the articles we'll mention tonight will be, a few of the things we mentioned that'll be mentioned tonight will be available there. So before we get into this, I do have just a couple brief announcements. For those who may not be aware, LUA will be expanding into two live shows a week starting on June 5th. The new dates will be Sunday and Thursday from 7 to 9 p.m. Central Standard Time. That will push the Sunday time slot back an hour, so make a special note of that. Also consider supporting LUA financially as we double down on our efforts. Just visit paypal.me/LUA radio to make a quick one-time donation, or visit the website for other options. You can also support us on Patreon. That is tinyurl.com/LUA Patreon. And even get rewarded for your support. So, Kyle, there have been a lot of developments since the last LUA Radio Special Edition titled The Sovereign Citizens Are Douchebags. And there seems to be a conclusion of sorts, which I know I'm happy about. But still, it wasn't exactly what I was hoping for. It wasn't necessarily ideal, but we'll get more into that. So first off, we'll cover the developments with the fake judges, Anna Von Wright, Bruce Doucette, and Gary Darby, and also the debate that LUA attempted to organize. Secondly, we will cover my article on the National Liberty Alliance, titled The National Liberty Alliance is Attempting to Subvert the Committee of Safety Concept. You can find that at tinyurl.com/end the NLA. Similarly, we will compare and contrast the two organizations, NLA and the CUSA, and we'll also conclude with lessons learned. So we sincerely hope this will provide you with a better understanding of what is necessary and what is surely unnecessary in this goal of restoring liberty. So, so Kyle, let's get into the fake judges first. This all essentially started after your article on the subject went semi-viral. It drew a lot of criticism and some interesting circumstances, which led us to the situation we're in today, and also led us to do that that last LUA Radio Special Edition. So, the next step in our timeline is you getting in contact with Maggie. So why don't you walk us through that? Tell us a bit about her, who she is, and the first show that you did with her.
Well, let's see. I managed to get in contact with Maggie Rose, who has a broadcast on the Micro Effect. That's called the New Concord Hour. And I was invited on to talk about, well, a couple of things. The first of which was my article from back in 2012. Wow, that's like 4 years ago. My 2012 article about early American heroines. We also talked about the collaborative article that you and I did about the origins of the Harney County Committee of Safety. Briefly, we also talked about contemporary American political prisoners, and especially, you know, the archive you've got up on the LUA site. Mm-hmm. And I believe that was on May 5th. Then later, I think it was the following week on May 10th, I was invited back on to talk about the demonization of the San Luis Valley off-grid homesteaders in Costilla County last year. The other segment dealt with canceling your voter registration, which, of course, there's a page dedicated to that on the LUA site as well. Mm-hmm. And then more in passing, but not really the main focus of the May 10th broadcast, was touching on the phenomenon or the latest trend of the fake judges, because that is a noticeable detail of the Costilla County story, specifically about how Bruce Doucette basically marched into Costilla County at the behest of Roger Marsh and successfully broke up the group of off-grid homesteaders there, which both the county government, the Costilla County government, as well as the bigoted Hispanics in the town of San Luis were unable to pull off. So essentially Bruce Doucette did the job of the government for them, whether he intended to or not. And just mentioning that more in passing, and it's true, I did call him out very specifically, but I didn't really have a chance or really any time to get in any real depth on it because that wasn't the intention. The intention was to focus on Castilla County. But the following day, on May 11th, Maggie Rose faced some serious listener backlash from the previous day's interview. And I didn't really even have a chance to, like, really criticize the sovereign citizen ideology in any real depth. It was just more, the meet the judge event, and here comes the judge, here comes the judge, like that stupid song says. And it was really just more of a farce. And so that's pretty much kind of where it kind of went. And so the next time I was on the new Concord Hour was a few days ago on May 17th. It was actually earlier this week. And I actually went in detail about the fake judges and then the sovereign citizen ideology as well, most specifically with my article Only on Paper, which was written 2 years ago, where I go pretty much line by line through the sovereign citizen ideas because I had actually written a series of book reports on over half a dozen books written by their own adherents, people like John David Van Hove, who's also known as Johnny Liberty, J.M. Sovereign Godsent, Robert Menard, and others. So I know what I am talking about. I have studied their literature for years. So when I tell any audience that there's a pattern to their madness, so to speak, whether it be Uniform Commercial Code, the corporate United States myth, accepted for value, or anything else, this isn't based on like what one sovereign citizen said. This is based when I say things like that, it's based on an amalgamation of different things I've learned from their own literature right out of the horse's own mouths. J.M. Sovereign Godsent specifically, the subtitle to his book is The Sovereign Citizen Handbook. And it's kind of interesting how some of the fake judges now are saying, well, there's no such thing as a sovereign citizen. So it's kind of it's kind of interesting watching the I'm trying to think of the right word, Shane, but
The semantic games that are played constantly.
yeah, and it's a recurring feature. And so that's what I was trying to explain to the listeners, Maggie Rose's listeners on the Micro Effect. And earlier this week, they seemed to be a little bit more receptive, at least from what I could tell, at least from my bird's eye perch, I suppose. But the fact of the matter is that people were really kind of upset about it. Either upset in terms of not liking me, or not, or otherwise getting upset because of what I was talking about. Basically, that these so-called patriots had gone in and busted up a fellow patriot group, a different focus, and all of that. But that's what happened. And it wasn't just limited to Castilla County either, because then Bruce Doucette later went into Harney County and did the same thing.
Indeed, indeed, and yeah, you are correct on the 17th broadcast, the chat room. I think I was in there one other time, but I don't think it was. I think it was at the very first broadcast, so it wasn't discussing these subjects. But yeah, on the 17th, I mean, people are pretty receptive. People are pretty receptive in the chat room. Great points, Kyle. Great show. Like it, there was nothing real negative in there. So, yeah, the reception was definitely a lot better, at least in terms of the chat room. But I wanted to mention, because obviously this is something we've been dealing with for about 19 days, Kyle, since that went semi-viral. So,
Really that long?
yeah, it was May 1st, I'm pretty sure, when that article was published. So. And I guess it might have been a couple days after that, but it's been cut over a couple of weeks. So we've been dealing with this for a while. So since it seemed to me that a lot of the discourse was restricted to like Anna Von Reitz's website, like her blog post, which you can't. I was looking today because I wanted to respond to the newest one that she put up, Kyle, and you can't. It's just a PDF. Like there's no place to actually comment. I was gonna respond. But yeah, there was no place, nowhere. So it's pretty much res been restricted to blog posts, private emails, and things of that nature, where there's no actual public discussion on the subject. So what Liberty Under Attack tried to do, what I tried to do, was reach out the olive branch, extend the olive branch. Let's get a moderated debate set up. You can choose the host. You got you, the you guys can agree on the host. You can agree where it's held. You can agree on the rules, etc., etc. So this was like completely still open to negotiation. Which is what I expressed in that very first email. And I'll go ahead and get that pulled up for the for those of you viewing this. on the YouTube channel or the website. But this was the first email that I sent, and I'll read this for the benefit of those listening on the podcast version. So this was sent to Gary Darby, Bruce Doucette, and Anavon Wrights on May 12th. Hello, I hope all is well. I'm addressing the three of you due to a request made to me by the Patriot Committee to host, moderate a debate on the subject of the veracity of common law courts, the common law judges, and the efficacy of that process. We are live every Sunday from 7 to 9 p.m. Central Standard Time on the Freedom Phalanx Radio Network, and I am very interested in getting this scheduled, as this has been a hot topic within the Patriot community. I have Sunday, June 5th and June 12th open and would appreciate a response by Thursday, May 19th, so I can get it scheduled and promoted. This is your opportunity to advocate your position in a moderated debate. The proposed rules will be below, and I would love your input on those as well as potential questions that need to be asked. I'll go ahead and get the second one up. Rules. Number one, and these are just the proposed rules. One, respect each other's viewpoints and opinions. No ad hominems. Two, no tangents. Stick to the subject matter. And three, no interrupting. Thanks in advance. I look forward to hearing from you. So that was sent on May 12th. They had their deadline on May 19th. And I didn't want to bring up again, back to the 17th broadcast that, or the interview you did on the new Concord Hour. This was, you also revealed this on air too. So this was broadcasted over the airwaves, this debate. And, we do have reason to believe too, that Gary Darby was listening, because he did email Maggie during the broadcast. So yeah, he was definitely aware of the debate. Was listening. He was definitely aware of the debate, but to put it simply. So, this press release is put out on May 19th. On the last day that they could that they could accept, they didn't. But we'll get more into that here momentarily. It's also worth mentioning that the discussion. I didn't receive a response email from any of these three judges, these fake judges. Rather, it was done through an intermediary that really had nothing to do with it whatsoever. At least the debate. So. And Kyle wanted to move forward. I guess anything, any points there before I move on to this this next most interesting part, I think.
Well, I mean, it's just kind of interesting just to point out one more time that there was every effort made, whether it was behind the scenes or, like you mentioned a moment ago, me going public at one point after some of the behind the scenes stuff was being ignored, to try and really reach out to these folks who are self-declared judges, to give them an opportunity, because I do believe in free speech. I do believe that there are two sides to every story, and that the purpose of a moderated debate with consensually agreed upon rules, mutually agreeable rules, would be for civil discourse to take place, where the audience gets to kind of weigh and jockey between both sides of an issue, and then at the end of it, they can actually make an informed decision about what they think is, you know, right and proper and true. And that is what I wanted, was an opportunity for that to happen. But unfortunately, you know, I pretty much kind of find myself, at least publicly, telling at least my criticisms, which is fine in one sense, but that doesn't help, you know, the neutral listeners form any sort of informed opinion one way or another. Because they can't really hear the other side of the story other than, they don't have access to Gary Darby's email. So the only other thing is really Anavon Wrights' articles where she's basically saying, I'm a horrible, awful person. And this kind of leads into that other thing we'll get to in a bit here. But like she's saying, like, I'm a buddy, quote unquote, that was the word she used. I'm a buddy of John Duresh's. Who, of course, is the main poobah for the so-called National Liberty Alliance, which, of course, I'm not. So, like, the closest thing there is to, like, the other side of the story is basically a lot of ad hominems and just base patently false things, claims that she's making. And, of course, Bruce Doucette, as far as I'm aware of, he's just been mum this entire time.
Yeah. Yeah, indeed, indeed. So you kind of – we both kind of mentioned this in passing, but – I was kind of looking around, I was looking on Bruce Doucette's Facebook page, and, he shared a post, and, this was posted, shared from a bunch of different groups. So, this one's called Mortgage Equals Copyright Derivative. That's the name of this group. 1,500 members. Wow. Posted by a gentleman named, Kent. Quote, and I'm just going to read this in its entirety because I think this kind of shows this is a very, very revealing post. So, quote, as some may know, but most do not, I have been honored to have been invited to a summit in Anchorage, Alaska, sponsored and organized by Anavon Rights. The people in personal attendance and conference are some of the most intelligent and dedicated people this world has to offer, insofar as I'm concerned. The brilliant leadership of both Anna and Judge Bruce Doucette, former Illinois state prosecutor and attorney Bob Locke, who came over from the dark. An incredibly intelligent and well-versed individual, Lorna Marish, a former paralegal with a knowledge base that is limitless. Trust me, and Denny and a couple others who I'm not sure want their names publicly made known. With special telephone appearance with Gene Keating and one we all know and love, that the gnat in CPS's ass and birth and ecclesiastical expert Moose Mouse. Finally, Mr. Mark K, whose legal knowledge to procedure in court and judge speak is absolutely brilliant. We are three-fourths of the way through our summit, and the progress made is nothing less than stupendous. What is being done here is truly historic as we integrate this wonderful brain trust into a cohesive plan of attack to end the oppression and acts of terror conducted upon the domestic and global population. I want to mention this. I'm gonna take a step away from this. I want to mention this before I forget it. This was shared by Bruce. I think it was yesterday or the day before. So they weren't out of communication. Like they could have seen the emails and responded and said, "Hey, we're in Alaska. We don't have time this week. Let us re let's do this. Let's talk about this next week," or any response like that, you know, or just a response saying, "Hey, we're not interested. Talk to you later." So they definitely could have responded, but yeah, they just ignored the emails. But getting back to this, quote, "We are confident we have these bankers, brokers, bar attorneys, county recorders, judges, sheriffs, and others who have caused us harm by the short hairs, to which escape is not going to be possible. There are solutions we are leaning towards and favoring status correction, the true and correct manner, absent the many guru and extreme ways, rather taking the practical way consistent to actual foundation of facts. Secondly, collapsing the trust and essentially probating the concealed living trust with conveyance of all assets, insurances, and annuities back to their rightful beneficiary, you and I. Essentially, in phrase, we are going to bring about the death of Black Acre and the skip by our resurrection landing our feet upon the land. It is an unwinding process of patented and trademarked processes, or to state another way, we are no longer on double secret probation, to borrow a phrase from Animal House. It is over. Our next task now is drawing up the step-by-step process that shall free us all. The impossible is close at hand, from Alaska to Florida for kickoff another line of attack that is this mass joinder. Thanks be to God for bringing a great team together." End quote. And Kyle, I mentioned to you in private conversations, like when we've been talking about UCC, that there was a person in my sovereign citizen group back in 2014 that was like designated to focus on UCC, and I was kind of surprised when I saw this post, because the first comment on here, the first comment was in fact that lady tasked with studying UCC, so that was just kind of another interesting overlap in this whole kerfuffle that we find ourselves discussing now. So, Kyle, I'll turn it over to you. What's on your mind?
Well, I guess the first thing to kind of point out here is anybody taping this summit? Because last time I checked, whenever the Ludwig von Mises Institute or any of these anti-establishment or activist organizations of any kind have their conferences, their freedom festivals, their summits, or whatever the hell. Generally speaking, they're all videotaped, at least the parts where they have speakers go up and give a lecture, or they have a Q&A, or they do have a panel, or whatever the presentation is. So is anybody taping this, or even just audio recording, even if you don't have any visual? Is anybody actually recording the proceedings in Anchorage, Alaska? Does anybody know?
I would not expect to see any video from that. I definitely would not. But yeah, that is a good point, the transparency concern.
So yeah, notice they're having these secret behind closed doors meetings is the point here. Unless someone would like to correct me, I don't think this summit was advertised ahead of time. In fact, you know, I kind of find myself embroiled in something that should not have been a controversy regarding the fake judges, but it's since become that because apparently some people really did believe the fake judges were legitimate even after I kind of wrote my article about it and then was interviewed by Maggie on it. But it's kind of rather interesting, right? Was this summit in Anchorage, Alaska, was this, you know, advertised for? Like, how many people knew about it beforehand? Because apparently, I think this Ken fellow who posted it on Facebook, it was posted yesterday, right?
I'll pull it back up and just double check. Yeah, yesterday.
Yesterday, and then notice in the second paragraph, he said, we are three-fourths of the way through our summit. So basically, while the fake judge controversy has been going on, this summit has been happening at approximately the same time, I would assume, unless it's a weekend get together or whatever, or a week-long thing. I mean, they don't tell you, notice they don't say anything when the summit started or anything like that. So to be perfectly fair to the viewers, I am speculating a little bit here in terms of the length of time. But hey, I'm finding this out pretty much in real time and in some ways after the fact. So that's the problem with the sovereign citizens or American state nationals, or you mentioned UCC a moment ago, commercial redemptionists, or whatever specific flavor, free men on the land being another one. They do this stuff in behind closed doors. Much like how I've criticized some of the Bitcoin lobbyists and other types of so-called political activists of one stripe or another, the sovereign citizens are just doing the same thing. They don't care about transparency. They don't care about proving their ideology and satisfying Hitchens' razor by bearing their burden of proof. It just lie constantly. And so when you have someone like me come along and say, hey, I canceled my voter registration. I did it successfully. Here's the paperwork. And I reclaimed unclaimed property, and I showed the evidence for that, the photographs and all that of the check. I think I've borne my burden of proof here, or at least even if I didn't objectively, I at least made the effort. These guys don't make the effort. And then when a critic comes along saying, hey, where's your evidence? In good faith, I'd like to see it. You're a shill, you're a troll, you're a. I think there were some other choice terms. I think we'll get to here shortly. But basically, they assume you're acting in bad faith, even when, in my case, I was acting in good faith. So it's kind of the question here: who is really acting in good faith here, and who is actually acting in bad faith? I think the actions by individuals on both sides of this unfortunate controversy, I think, kind of shows that to the audience.
Indeed, indeed, and it was kind of interesting because in that post by Ken, Darby's not mentioned in that, Darby's not mentioned in that, and he was listening to the Maggie Rose's show, the New Concord Hour. So I don't think he was in attendance at this thing. Obviously I don't know that for sure, but that is definitely interesting, and some of those emails, Maggie read one of them on air. But he pretty much, I guess, I think he thinks you're kind of like a professional propagandist or something, which was really, really, that was definitely a strange way to put it for me. As you kind of said, when someone criticizes what they're doing or asks for evidence, it automatically goes to government shill or controlled opposition or what anything like that. So that's definitely disconcerting that there can't be any open discourse on the subject, as can be shown by the fact that the debate was denied.
Well, yeah, and so sorry to go back to this same Facebook post by Ken here. I mean, what is the concealed living trust? Just to point out one other thing, at least briefly, what is this concealed living trust that's mentioned? I mean, I'd like to know what the name. I honestly would, even having gone through this fake judge controversy myself. What is this concealed living trust? I'd like to know. But you see, there's never any firm answers. They make claims just from every which direction. And then when anybody acts as a skeptic, acting in good faith, and kind of like what some other activist groups would say, ask questions, demand answers, try and get some proof, you're a villain, you're a bad person, even for just asking the question. It's like, well, geez. If the sovereign citizens and their ilk are acting that way, I mean, what makes them different from the government?
Yeah, that is definitely a good point. So, the deadline has passed. The deadline was yesterday, and we've gotten no response. They've chosen not to have the courage of their convictions to defend their ideology and their methods publicly. All we've gotten is excuses or nothing at all. So, they're gonna continue doing what they're doing, Kyle. They're going to. Obviously, they've got a lot of stuff in the works, and it seems like from that post that it's another one of those those magic bullets, the silver bullet solutions, where you do this and everyone has their freedom back, which I'm not a big fan of those things. It's not realistic at all.
Well, but not
it's
only,
definitely not
but not only that, but they've already tried. They've already tried something, or technically, it's in motion. What I mentioned in, I think it was the last interview I did with Maggie earlier this week, there was the so-called international commercial lien with the 52 so-called lien claimants, three of which, three of the, you know, the three fake judges are comprised, you know, some of that, those 52. And there's like PII in there too, stuff I'm not comfortable repeating publicly, even though it is now publicly available right off of Anna Von Reitz's website, like, you know, full legal names, phone numbers, email addresses, mailing and physical addresses. And it's like, okay, like what part of United States versus Philip Marsh did you people not understand when the judge, the actual government judge, not a fake judge, but back in, I think it was 1998, when the judge said the filing of the lien is the crime? Like, I'm sorry. I mean, is everybody like completely brain dead here, or is it just they're not understanding what I'm saying, or is it willful ignorance? Like, I don't know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that is true. And I remember when we were preparing for this, you brought up a gentleman named Ian Bernard. He's up there in the Free State Project, he's been very good about transparency, unlike these folks that are filing documents in court. So I guess in regards to Ian, has he tried any of the sovereign citizen stuff? Can you tell us a bit about that?
Yes, maybe this kind of merits its own article just for the purposes of details. I don't know if I want to do that or not. But for anybody who wants to go look at the Freekeen website, you know, I've criticized Ian Bernard about some other stuff in the past, and I still stand by those criticisms. However, I, in the attempt to be fair and even-handed towards him, because he does do some good things that I think are, you know, should be emulated. This would be one of those things that I think should be emulated if you were to go and use the government's laws, try and somehow use the government's laws against them, or try legal experiments, which may or may not work, that if you are going to do that, you should be transparent about it, like Ian Bernard did, where he was uploading his own court documents, and in some ways, even kind of as a nicer add-on, even getting trial footage, where you can actually see him stand up and argue in front of the judge and whatever else. And so you can kind of see, you know, what did he... So there's even a possibility for the rest of us to kind of Monday night quarterback in one sense or another. And, you know, so we have Ian Bernard to thank for that, because without that, there wouldn't even be the chance for even Monday night quarterbacking, if you think about it. But yeah, he did admit that some of the sovereign citizen stuff, when he was first trying it out, he doesn't do that anymore. He now tries statutory remedies. He tries other things. But yeah, he tried some of the more sovereign citizen techniques of one flavor or another, and they constantly failed. Actually, they consistently failed too. So Bernard, in good faith, he tried it, and he just was, you know, very straight up about it. And I wouldn't be surprised if he got a lot of flack for that too. But, you know, this is the thing. I mean, when it comes to sovereign citizens and their methods of accepted for value or commercial liens, or you know, pick something out of a hat, ultimately, we're not even really so much talking about an ideology, although there is the corporate United States myth and related ideas, which are all bunk for other reasons. In a lot of ways, it's not so much an ideology that's important as it is the methodology, the how-to, the what magic words on the magic piece of paper do we file with the magical government? You know, the magical courts or whatever. I mean, it's that's pretty much where it is. So when Anna Von Reitz has her international commercial lien with 52 lien claimants on it, asking for... I don't have it right up in front of me, but I think it was like either millions or trillions of dollars. It was a lot of money, whatever it was. Probably more than even the Federal Reserve has. you know, it's kind of like, wow, okay, that's interesting. And also notice too that in that commercial lien document of hers, which she actually issued last year, I believe it was in October sometime, same month when Bruce Doucette pulled his stunt in Castilla. Shane, you remember like with a lot of the political prisoner documents, there's the markings from PACER where you see like the case number in blue and the document number and the date and all that.
Oh yeah, I'll pull that up on screen for the listeners to see what we're kind of referring to. But yeah, I've looked at a lot of court documents. I know exactly what you mean. They're staple marker at the top, yeah.
The international commercial lien, which anybody can download off of Anna von Reitz's website, doesn't have any of that stuff. So there really much is a question being raised, like, did she even file it in federal court or any government court? That's kind of an open question. I honestly don't know. The only thing I can tell you is that if you look at the political prisoner documents and look for like the different, government markings that it's been through the PACER system, and then you look at the international commercial lien off of her website, it's also equally possible that, and I am speculating here, that she just typed it up and then exported it as a PDF file and then just simply uploaded it to her website and that was it. Like, so she didn't actually file the lien. She just uploaded a document called a lien, acted as if she's, a big shit, but didn't actually file it.
Yeah.
So, like, I don't know. It's an open question. If anybody would like to follow up on that and, let me know, I'd appreciate it. But I don't know, Shane. I mean, when it gets to the fake judges, unfortunately, there's more questions than answers. And the only real answer at this point, besides the fact their ideology is fake, that I debunked 2 years ago, is that they don't even want to have a debate. They don't want to answer my questions that were at the end of my Only on Paper article. They don't want to even engage in civil discourse. I mean, think how low that is. Not even civil discourse. I mean, it's just so they don't want to act like civilized men and women. They just don't. They have their little diatribes. They have their little special vested special interest. And they're going to pursue that no matter what. And that's and just straight up, that's what it is.
Yeah, and it's even a little worse than that too, Kyle. Reason being, I've said this many times before, but I mean that the first sign to brainwashing is the inability to seek out the other's opinions, or their beliefs, and obviously check the validity, the credibility with an open mind, in order to actually determine what the truth is. Now you, Kyle, you went through their literature as you stated. You went through the literature, you watched a ton of their stuff, and you came to your conclusion. You documented it all. But one thing I've seen lacking on their end is. It's like a lack of understanding of, or they just don't even, they don't even have enough respect for you to actually look at what you actually believe. I mean, a couple examples of that. I mean, first off, they thought Liberty Under Attack was your website, which, if they can't even figure out whose website is whose, then why are people going to trust these folks to file documents in court and stuff? So, that's the first thing. The second thing is, you mentioned one of the claims that you're like one of the sycophants for John Duresh or something like that,
Yeah, Anna von Reitz accused me of that, yeah.
It's completely fallacious. I mean, I mean, you're a professional propagandist. There was, I don't know. There's just a lot of stuff that I've seen in the responses where it's just so intellectually dishonest, so intellectually dishonest.
Yeah, and that's kind of where it's been. So yeah, just to let the viewers know, the debate is not going to happen, but you know what? It wasn't for a lack of trying, the olive branch was extended and it was basically broken in half and shoved back right back in our faces. And that's pretty much what happens, at least symbolically.
Yep, that is true, and it definitely is disconcerting because this is a big issue in the Patriot community right now. As we're talking about with the response that Maggie got for even having you on the show to talk about this, it's something that needs to be debated publicly in order for the for I guess for the Patriots to go ahead and set up local committees of safety, and not be distracted by this. They need to figure out what is the truth. They need to come to their own conclusions when the evidence is presented and move forward from there. But unfortunately, that's not going to happen. It's still going to be relegated to private blogs, private emails, and I don't know. I would say, hopefully, we don't have to talk about this again. But yeah, it's just going to continue. It's going to continue, unfortunately.
Well, I think there was that article of yours that was kind of interesting, almost as a parallel development, maybe even intertwined at least to some degree, that I kind of found fascinating, speaking of committees of safety.
Oh yeah, yep. That is true. That is true. And yep, that's what we'll get to next. This is in regards to the National Liberty Alliance. Now, Kyle, I'm not as familiar with this as you, but can you kind of briefly just explain, like, I guess the history and I guess the feuding between CUSA and NLA, as I guess succinctly as you can.
Yeah, sure. I mean, I don't know if there's really much to say. I think I pretty much mentioned this in my article, which is entitled Disingenuous Activists: Why Leaderless Resistance is Preferable to Formal Organizations. And in there, I think I only took about one paragraph or so because I was going through a bunch of very different case studies involving a lot of different political activist groups of one kind or another. And one of those was the feuding between the so-called continental United States of America, and that's united with a small u, but with a capital N for some reason, and between CUSA, oh, and by the way, the fake judges are part of that, by the way. Between the fake judges and their CUSA versus John Duresh and the National Liberty Alliance, or NLA. And, you know, both groups push the formation of so-called citizens' grand juries, but they really, really don't like each other. And this is very apparent in not just several articles of Anna von Wright's, where she then lumps me in with Duresh. But even in one or two articles, I think, even by NLA, like officially on their website, they actually tried to rebut at least a few of her articles, at least up until that point, and then she responded back. So, like, there's this flurry of articles where basically it's kind of like a pissing contest. Like, I
Oh,
mean.
so Duresh responded to her, but I'm probably not gonna. We'll get back and get into that. But yeah, I probably won't get a response. Sorry, but go ahead.
Well, that's pretty much just what it is, right? I mean, you have sovereign citizen A versus sovereign citizen B, and they should be on the makeout couch with, I don't know, Nancy Pelosi and Newt Gingrich, or, you know, pick an authoritarian, but then they're instead at each other's throats because of some slight disagreement over how the corporate United States was put together, and or I don't even full, and to be perfectly honest, I was looking at their articles back and forth, and even I couldn't fully understand it. I've studied them for years. And sorry, let me just mention this briefly before you get on with that article you did, which was fantastic. The sovereign citizen ideology and their methodology is filled with so much nuance and minutiae, almost nobody can understand it. And some of it you're not supposed to understand. So that's kind of very important to really kind of come to grips with, is that I've seen people actually, you know, even people who are friends of mine from years back, literally kind of go crazy, go nuts. And next thing you know, they're talking about, you know, flat Earth or whatever. Actually, supposedly in some other articles I've read, people were some of the journalists were able to source Bruce Doucette's Facebook post where apparently he believes in a flat Earth. So, you know, it's kind of like, okay, so you're a fake judge, you bust up the homesteaders, you're screwing around with the Harney County Committee of Safety, and you believe in a flat Earth, Mr. Doucette? Judge. That's rather interesting. And if you don't like me, why don't you file a contempt of court action? Because apparently the entire world is your court. And that's not a joke, because that's right in the fake oath about he has jurisdiction like everywhere on the planet. I'm not joking. It's in my fake judges article where you can look at each of their fake oaths, and
Yep,
for
I can get that up if you want me to.
sure,
Those do sets.
we'll just briefly, but yeah, Gary Darby and Bruce Doucette's oath specifically mention about how they have worldwide jurisdiction. Kind of as a side note, kind of sounds similar when George W. Bush was claiming that the entire world is a battlefield in the global war on terror. It's a little bit like, it's a lot like that.
So would it be the section, quote, I do protect, shield, and defend the lands.
Oh, no, it should be somewhere kind of down where it's like, I have jurisdiction.
Okay, I have jurisdiction in all matters of all states and estates, nations and countries where oppression, tyranny, suffrage, peonage. This is hard to read. They put up a really bad scan. Piracy, slavery of any type, involuntary servitude, antitrust, monopolizing, etc., etc., etc. So yeah, jurisdiction in all matters of all states and estates, nations and countries. So yeah, you got your New World Order judge right there.
Yeah, so basically, I think at least as far as this portion of it goes, the fake judges are the New World Order judges because they're claiming jurisdiction over the entire blasted planet. And until people really follow up on the sources that I wrote about in the fake judges article, and you know, they kind of, you know, wind their necks back in if they happen to really think I'm like, you know, the devil or whatever. Follow up on the sources I linked in and then make a decision. But yeah, I mean, like, The vitriol I have dealt with, I remember when Alex Ansari was mentioning about the vitriol he was getting because of what he covered with the Costilla County story. And I could appreciate that on an intellectual level, but I couldn't appreciate that intuitively until I was dealing with the backlash to the fake judges article. And now I get it. So, and see, that's the other thing too. It would be one thing if this came from people who are at least openly honest about being authoritarians, but quite frankly, this is a lot of this vitriol is coming from people, Shane, that are just, they claim to value freedom, they claim to value liberty, but they quite frankly just don't when they're siding with fake judges who claim literally worldwide dictatorship over the entire planet. And that's one other thing too, very briefly. Anna von Wright's also mentioned her articles that we are sovereign. And when I was on the New Concord Hour earlier this week, I actually read the legal definitions for the word sovereign, not just from one legal dictionary and not even just from two, but I cross-referenced it with three legal dictionaries, Ballantine's, Bouvier's, and Black's. And all three of them said that if somebody says that they are a sovereign, they are telling you literally that they are your ruler. Now, last time I checked, if somebody's going to be an advocate of liberty, even if they want a constitution for whatever strange reason, we have to be able to live without rulers. That kind of has to be a must be. Because liberty itself is also legally defined as an absence of servitude or restraint. So if you want to have an absence of servitude and restraint, it would seem to make sense to me that we would first have to live without rulers in order to have that absence of servitude and restraint. But no,
Precisely.
the sovereign citizens generally, and the fake judges specifically, they are authoritarian. They are claiming to literally be our rulers. And so when you have, just one guy like over here in the corner, being myself, with Alex Ansari kind of at least in his own way, kind of before me, kind of discovering it and trying to make sense of it as best as he could. But of course, he was dealing with a lot of crap at the time last year when all that was going down in Costilla. I come along later, find out what happened to him, and then I follow up on it. I figured that there's this whole other scene going on between CUSA and NLA and them tricking people into signing these international commercial liens and all this other just garbage.
Yeah, that is definitely true. That is definitely true. But let's go ahead and move forward to this article and kind of work through that, because this is going to be, I was hoping for an hour, but it's definitely going to be longer than that. And that's fine. There's a lot to get through here. So I guess the first thing to mention here, in regards to the National Liberty Alliance, was when I was in that sovereign citizen group, we were in contact. That our group was in contact with some folks from National Liberty Alliance, and there was supposed to be some, I guess, merging or working together of the groups. And I actually started financially contributing to NLA, so I've known about them for a couple of years now. A couple of years now, along with Reese of the Republic for the United States of America, with the weird capitalization that Kyle was mentioning. So yeah, I did financially contribute to the National Liberty Alliance. And it's also worth mentioning that before we even get into this, I'd recommend everyone go to fprnradio.com/liberty-under-attack and listen to the January 3rd broadcast, the first edition of the Direct Action series, when Gary Hunt joined us to discuss committees of safety. Definitely do that, either before or after, but make sure you do that at some point. And you'll kind of see that some of the stuff they're bringing into this doesn't actually fit in. It's actually contrary to the concept itself. So I guess I'll kind of start here. On the evening of May 15th, I was made aware of the National Liberty Alliance's Committee of Safety page, which is in fact right here. And I was also made aware of their registry. Let me just refresh this and make sure there's not more than 50, but we'll get into that. Okay, we're solid 50 for the show. So I was perusing their Committee of Safety page, and the PowerPoint presentation right here, it was just outright atrocious. It was. I mean, there was obviously they like to involve the county sheriff. They like to involve hell yeah. In the article, I even mentioned. Well, this was the part that confused me the most. But on one of the slides, they even had the audacity to bring up chemtrails, the New World Order, and FEMA camps in their PowerPoint presentation. A COS is a local government. As such, how can they begin to deal with these problems? So, They dragged in a bunch of stuff into this PowerPoint presentation that doesn't have any place with communities of safety, and especially when you drag in like chemtrails and stuff like that, that automatically is a loss of credibility. Automatically. I've been in a lot of those groups, and I've seen some of the dissenters, people that disagree and think that they use those ad hominem such. Oh, you're nutty, you're crazy, you're a conspiracy theorist. So that stuff's not necessary for committees of safety. It's not something COSs deal with. So yeah, I don't know why they decided to put those in. But those are just a few things I noticed in that PowerPoint presentation. And it was also like it was also a struggle to get through. I think I got through I got through like 10 or 15 minutes of it, and I said, okay, yep, this is not good. I couldn't even get through the entire thing. So this one was about, I think it was about 22 minutes, and the one that's on the LUA YouTube channel right now is I think it's about 10 minutes, isn't it, Kyle?
I think it was something like that. Yeah, it was. I mean, the whole point behind that was to quick and dirty, and not even focusing on history so much, because there had been previous complaints about too much history, let's get more to practical stuff. So I was trying to do that as and cater to that market demand as much as possible.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely. But yeah, there were a couple, I guess I'll mention this too, a COS seal. Now I guess before I get into this, if you are interested in the Committee of Safety concept at all, go to committee.org. It's how it's spelled. COMMITEE.org. You can find, that was the original archive with all the information and such. And you won't see these things on there. So one of the documents was a COS seal, a call to sheriff for first or second visit, and example resolution. I'll go ahead and pull those up real quick to put them on screen for you guys. But as I said, the sheriff has no parts in. And I'll just read this part from the article here. To keep this short, I'll just say the NLA has no understanding whatsoever of how a COS is formed. They have no understanding of what it entails and cannot promote the concept without incorporating the failed attempts of an allegedly common law citizen's grand jury, as well as the inefficacious concept of the county sheriff, who is an elected official within the existing government. By contrast, a COS is a parallel government. The two are separate and by their nature remain as such. So this that's something that they want you to. Oh wow, that's the Kyle. The call to sheriff for first or second visit for a Ford.
You're joking.
No. Well, that's. Hold on. Let me go to their page and find that one real quick. This might have. Let's see.
Hey! Live investigations in real time are always fun. What'd you find?
Agenda for first meeting with the sheriff. Let's see if hopefully that's not a. Okay. Yeah. It looks like they replaced it. I don't see that exact agenda. Let's pull up this one. Yeah, this is you're listening to this. Well, you're not listening to it live, but yeah, like what we're doing this, we're finding out. Yeah, they changed the document. Okay, well, that's good to know. But as you can see, the Committee of Safety seal, that's not necessary. It's really not necessary. Just the example resolution with stuff that doesn't have to be there. I mean, let's see. The constitutionally based common law administration to lay any court abuses or public servant bad behavior before the judicial system. The COS has to be formed first before you put together these documents. So, I don't know. I'm kind of taken aback now that document wasn't there, Kyle.
Well, you know, I don't know, man. It's just they, you know, they change their story. They mess you around and. I don't know. I don't really like the National Liberty Alliance because they don't really have a national reach. It's not anything representing an alliance, and it has nothing to do with liberty.
Yeah, it does look like. Yeah, it looks like this page was restructured, and there's also a new Committee of Safety meeting on the 19th. Yeah, that'll have to be something we follow up on after. Yeah, I'm looking. Yeah, it looks like they restructured the page a little bit. And there's a couple videos. Donald Trump video, fall of the dollar economic collapse, which I don't know what that has to do with committees of safety. 2016 monetary collapse. We prepared to start a committee of safety.
No, okay. If that's what they're saying, then they're just no. That's unnecessary. That's scaring people. That's not how you. And by the way, There might be some folks who disagree with what I'm about to say, but they should hear it. Scaring people and fear-mongering is not how you motivate and attract people to you if you want them to do something that's positive and constructive, and especially if it's collaborative, like what a committee of safety requires. If you want to encourage people, you have to broach them in such a way where you're appealing to their better nature, where you're appealing to their self-interest, yes, but also in a long-term sense as well. For example, if you consider yourself, for those of you who consider yourselves like prepper types, the absolute worst way of approaching it is basically scaring people with doom porn, which I've also written about in the past. A better way of doing it is basically telling people about the importance of self-sufficiency and not paying the government for your utilities and not being under the thumb of municipal ordinances and so forth, which, oh, by the way, that's what a portion of those off-grid homesteaders in Castilla County were there for, because they had moved out of the cities. And then they were facing their own struggles there with the county government for what I've already written about. So, you know, it's so yes, if on the NLA page for committees of safety, or I should say disinformation about committees of safety, if they're like spreading Donald Trump and economic the interminable economic non-collapse that keeps not happening, then yeah, that's fear-mongering, that's doom porn. It's just fake and phony. I mean, at that point, I mean, why don't we just hitch our wagons up to the social justice warriors and the warmongering neocons, because it's about just as legitimate.
Okay, and I was able to ascertain what happened there. They changed it from a dot doc file to a dot PDF file, so it's exactly the same, but it's just a different file format, which is interesting. I'm not quite sure what's going on there, but yeah, we're finding this stuff out while we're doing this recording. So, I guess now that we've kind of moved past that, after I wrote this article, there was some there was quite a bit of backlash. People would I mean obviously with the backlash, it kind of insinuated that the NLA, or at least their members, did not like this article being up. There were a number of requests to take it down. People asked me to remove it. They tried to censor LUA, and obviously I'm not going to take it down. But what we did actually was we put together I guess you could say a list of demands of sorts. I'm not sure what else to call it, an amicable resolution. So the NLA didn't like this being up. It's harmful to their organization, and I'll get to one of their. Actually, before I move forward, I apologize. Let's look at their registry first before I even get into that. So, this is their Committee of Safety registry. If you click register your Committee of Safety here, help, Kyle. Should I register a new Committee of Safety on air here?
I think you should, if you don't mind. I think that if you're up for it, I think that would be fun for people to see that. And remember, just for people who may not understand the scientific method, good science is repeatable. So yeah, I guess that's what Shane here is doing now, is he's just repeating what he already admitted to doing before in his article. And it's interesting too. You know, I was checking the other day that same, you know, phony COS registry on the NLA's website, and they still haven't taken down your already openly admitted, you know, fake entry, which kind of throws the whole registry into question if they're not even vetting the applications
Hey,
that are being
it's
submitted.
already up there. It's already up there. Jesus Christ. Okay, yeah, that was automatically added to the list.
Hold on, is there any way you can zoom in on that so people can look at it a little bit better?
I don't even know if Johnson County is a real county in Illinois. I just pulled something out of my ass. Yeah, that's you guys only put that in. This is yes, that went automatically onto the registry. Now there's 51, and I have two committees of safety in two different counties. Yay. So I think it's worth mentioning as well that whenever I put up this article, there were I think 11 or 12 committees of safety registered. So in about 3 days, it's already up to oh yeah, it's already up to 50. So yeah, there's a problem there. And I went into this in the article, and I'll give you guys the short link to that. It's tinyurl.com/endtheNLA, and I definitely recommend you read through this. But yeah, there are a lot of problems with that. I mean, there's also a registry at committee.org, and I'll go ahead and pull that one up too, just so you guys can get an idea of how many committees of safety there actually are. Oh man,
Yeah, and
directory.
that's and that true registry database or whatever the list is going years and years and years back. I mean, what the NLA has done is they're basically pulling a Johnny come lately routine. And you know, you could also say that about the fake judges too as well. I mean, see, sorry, one other thing too, let me mention this briefly while you're pulling that up. Consider also, and it's not just the fake judges, but also like NLA and their recent I guess fad is notice that they're pretty much doing this either earlier this year or sometime last year. I mean, think about it. Where were these guys when the Bundy affair, the cattle unrustling during the Bundy affair was going down? Where were they when Occupy Wall Street was happening? Where were they when the first wave of Tea Partiers was happening right at the beginning of El Presidente's first term in office? Where were these people? Were they sitting down with their thumbs up their butts?
Yeah, that's that is definitely a good question. In regards to the registry, as you can see here on the committee.org page, there's two in Georgia, there's one in North Carolina, and there is one in Harney County, Oregon. But the COS themselves has voluntarily list their committee of safety. Yeah, there's only three on this page. I think there may be five tops, like actually verified committees of safety. But here on this page, you actually have to contact the webmaster. They will give you a call, or you'll at least exchange emails. There's actually some sort of verification process. And with most of those COSs on that list, as I mentioned in the article, I think they probably view it as something like a White House.org position, like, I want to start a committee of safety. Let me put in my name and information. Now I have one in my county. When in reality, the process is more so you hold a public meeting, and I mean the people decide, the citizens of that county decide if they want to have a committee of safety, and then committee men are elected, and this has to be a quorum, an odd number, so there's no ties on issues that they vote on. And one of the things I did want to do was actually go through that list and call each one of those and just ask them a select few questions like, can I ask how many committee men were elected to your committee of safety? I think the second one would have been something along the lines of, okay, well, how many members are in your general association? What I would guess is that, like, after I ask that first question, they'll say, like, well, no, I haven't held the public meeting yet. I don't know that for sure. I didn't have a chance to do that today, but yeah, that's kind of something I want to do. Just I mean, as per the scientific method, to see if that is actually the case or not. So, I would proffer though that most of those are fake. I have two fake COSs now. So, Kyle, anything there, sir?
Yeah, I mean, just for everybody kind of looking at all of the, excuse me, for everybody kind of looking at this, what has now turned into a circus, and at this point, I mean, Shane and I are just documenting it really, is consider that if you ever find any of these sovereign citizens, whether it's NLA types or anybody else, and if they happen to be talking about committees of safety, here's a really easy question you can ask them. And Shane kind of mentioned this a moment ago. Ask them about their general association. From what little I've been able to put together, they don't even know what that is. And by the way, here's the hint, or I should say the answer. General association is the rank and file membership. So, yeah, there you go. They're not even going to know basic things like that because they're a bunch of Johnny come latelys who haven't studied it for years, like I have, and Gary Hunt has, even longer than I have, obviously, going actually decades back, and knowing what it really means and understanding that it is really about starting over in a very serious way. But if you think about it, a lot of people don't want to start over, Shane. They just want to become part of the establishment. They want to get nice, make nice with the county sheriffs. Even though in Texas here, the so-called constitutional sheriffs actually get free medical care, but apparently nobody cares about that. You know, taxpayer-funded medical care. That sounds like socialism, but it's constitutional. But I haven't heard any Tea Party types get angry about that. So Are they just ignorant? Or do they not? Do they know but they don't care? Or is there some other vested special interest where they do know about it? They might be slightly upset about it, but they're willing to sweep it under the rug because they want to make nice. I mean, I don't want to speculate too much, but suffice it to say, there's some really nasty politicking with a K going on here.
Indeed, indeed. And we are coming up on an hour, and we still have quite a bit to get through. So what I'm going to do, Kyle, is I'm going to end this first part, and when we come back, we'll get more into this and actually go into the list of demands that was sent in response to the backlash. So yeah, for you guys on YouTube, you'll see this instantly, but you'll be back in a couple of minutes. All right, and welcome back to the part two. Welcome back to part two of the May 20th LUA Radio Special Edition. Before we took that brief delay, we're just getting to the amicable resolution that was put forth after a bunch of this negative feedback on this article and requests for it to be taken down. This is what was returned to them, and just as in the last segment, covered and does join as joining me. But yeah, this is what my response was, what LUA response was to the National Liberty Alliance. So, good faith. First, is absolutely necessary that all occurrences of the existing PowerPoint, NLA Committee of Safety presentation of any video, audio, PowerPoint, PDF, doc, or other text format and/or HTML be removed immediately. There was a typo there, but anyways, this has to be removed wherever NLA has access in all forms, including YouTube, all NLA member pages, and any other known republication of that information. This sign of good faith must precede any action on our part to resolve this matter. NLA will notify Liberty Under Attack upon completion of the demonstration of their good faith. In addition, the following shall be accomplished by May 25th, 2016. All documents or other objects taken from the committee.org website or other information gleaned from that source shall be attributed to committee.org. Change reference of existing chairman to redacted for personal information at committee.org, chairman for the formation of committees of safety. And number three, blank will provide a revised copy for the NLA COS webpage. Once received, it must replace the existing page within 24 hours. Number four, any publication regarding committees of safety being disseminated by NLA will require the approval of the chairman before being presented to the public. Five, the chairman shall be notified in advance whenever his participation is necessary or in instances where committees of safety will be discussed. Retraction. Liberty Under Attack will publish a retraction at every location where the article in question, the National Liberty Alliance, is attempting to subvert the committee of safety concept, has been published. Upon receipt of a notice of compliance from NLA that all of the above items have been properly addressed, and then just my normal email signature. So that was what was put forth. And just to clarify this, retraction does not mean taken down. It means putting up like a note at the top of the article. So I would never take down any article I ever written. So that was the next step that followed all of those requests for it to be taken down. And this was sent to nine different leaders of NLA. And to this date, we have not received anything in return to this amicable resolution. Which that does kind of lead me to believe that they honestly do not want to reach an agreement and would rather see this fall down the memory hole and continue to promote a bastardized version of the COS concept. So before I move forward on to the I guess to kind of conclude this, Kyle, you shared an article with me during the intermission. We don't usually do that, but we did one tonight about Ross' story trying to connect committees of safety to the sovereign citizen movement. We discussed that before we move forward. So, I guess what was the author saying in this article, and how wrong was he or she?
Well, Travis Geddes wrote an article for Ross Story during the status turf war of 2016. So this would be last January, and he said specifically the following quote: "The Committee of Safety, made up of six community members, including a retired fire chief, two ranchers, and the president of the county's Republican Party, was formed to file grievances against the government. The concept is promoted by so-called sovereign citizen groups and is based on shadow governments set up by the Continental Congress in the months before the American Revolution," said J.J. McNabb, an expert on right-wing extremist groups, close quote. So as you can see there's an attempt to chill dissent, much like I wrote about in that other article of mine about chilling dissent, how the government demonizes Americans. So that's pretty much that. So the fix was in other words, during the status turf war, that apparently there was an active ongoing attempt to trash COS vis-a-vis the Harney County Committee of Safety specifically is what Travis Geddes was referring to there.
Indeed, indeed. And that actually brings to memory, I think it was put in our Harney County, in our collaborative article, Kyle, on the origins of the Harney County Committee of Safety and the comments from Sheriff David Ward to Chris Briles, the ex-fire chief. The same similar semblance is portrayed there as well. It's not a legal group. You don't know what you're doing, et cetera, trying to demonize the Committee of Safety concept. Any final thoughts on that before I move forward?
Not really. I mean, it's just kind of the committees of safety are being trashed, and whether it's by the established government or whether it's by the National Liberty Alliance, just getting trashed six ways come Sunday, even though there have been individuals like yours truly who have been promoting and trying to describe what it is, what it has been historically, the fact that it not just worked in the American Revolution of the 1770s, but also in the Texas Revolution of the 1830s. But not many people seem to give a damn, and whenever they do decide to, they spread misinformation and disinformation and claim it's a sovereign citizen thing, even when it's not. So that's kind of what's happened.
Yeah, and NLA is definitely not helping that. So I guess at this point we're kind of looking at a negative. We didn't get a response. The Committee of Safety Power Proposition is still up. They kind of redid their page a little bit, but from a quick scan of it today, it seems to be essentially the same thing. It looks like they might have just changed a couple of file formats. I don't know if it was to try to make the links in my article not useful anymore, but they can't can't be the reason, because they know I can just update the links. But so it looks kind of pessimistic here, but actually there was one instance, and obviously for privacy concerns, I'm not going to reveal any names or anything like that, and I don't think that's necessary, but I had a gentleman from my email list tell me that he appreciated the article and had a feeling there was something off with the NLA. He subsequently canceled his subscription. So it is confirmed that this has hit them financially. I don't know if this is the only one, or if he's the only one that I don't know if this is the only one possible, or if this is the only one that has come forward. But hopefully there are others that are doing the same, because I don't know. Kyle, you're mentioning that in one of those COS, actually it was the emergency meeting, right? And Duresh was just asking for money and shit.
Yeah, there was a so-called Committee of Safety meeting of sorts, which wasn't really a meeting. It was just a conference call where John Duresh was just taking calls. And he was constantly begging for money, like, the entire time. And it was really just god-awful annoying for me to listen to it. And at one point, I just started, you know, working on some other, you know, upcoming articles that I'd like to get up on the blog, while I'm listening to Duresh just, you know, demand people give him money, not because he's actually producing anything of value that his, I can't say audience now, can I? But whomever he's appealing to, his membership, let me put it that way, of NLA, he's not producing anything of value, at least that I can find, even if I personally disagree with it. I can't find anything of value. He's just sitting on his bum, you know, basically giving out a lot of, making some rhetoric, but there's no, like, solid product. There's no anything. I mean, hell, there's not even any merch. I mean, just nothing.
Yeah.
But give me money because I said to. And he was even saying, like, $1,000 at one point.
Yeah, that's it. So I guess if just, I guess, intellectual honesty doesn't matter to him, the rest of the claims that he's making, then maybe our only course of action now is to just continue spreading the article around, and maybe when they see a drop in membership, which would mean also a drop in finances as well, then maybe that will be motivation for them to correct their bad behavior.
Yeah, I would certainly hope so. I mean, I guess I can go on a further limb than maybe even you, Shane, but I would love it if NLA would just abolish itself, much like the government, you know? I
Hey,
mean,
I agree with that for sure.
yeah, I mean, what I mean, and for the viewers who may disagree with me on that point, just ask yourselves this: what value has the so-called National Liberty Alliance provided to you? I mean, what have they done for you? And you know, I think how you answer that question will at least at least give a little bit more credence to the abolition position regarding NLA, or hell, maybe even the government more generally. You never know.
Yep, indeed, indeed. And I'll give out that short link again. And as that short link says, tinyurl.com/end the NLA. So let's go ahead and move forward here. Before we get to conclusion, I think it's important to early on in the in this LUA Radio Special Edition, we discussed the fake judges. And in the second part, we were discussing or we just kind of finished discussing the National Liberty Alliance in the article that I published a few days ago. I think it's important to draw a parallel here as to why both of these things correlate with each other, at least in some sense, and to kind of I guess try to suss this out a little more. So, I guess do you want to I guess here in our notes we have and you've already discussed this, but the COSA they've been squabbling with each other. They don't like each other too much. But they are both sovereign citizens groups. They may not like the titles. Some may rather be claimed American nationals or freemen on the land, etc., etc. But there's definitely some disagreement between these two groups. But I think the comparison here is that they're both trying to set up common law grand juries.
Yeah, and the interesting thing too is, and just to be clear on one detail, because somebody at NLA got really butthurt about it, I never said there were fake judges at NLA, and I don't think you did either. The fake judges are part of CUSA, and CUSA and NLA hate each other's guts. And I think Anna Von writes, well, actually, I learned that from her. So that's pretty much according to her position. But yeah, they're both trying to set up these so-called citizens grand juries. Oh, and one other thing too, Shane, in your article on NLA, there was that screenshot that you showed that was like straight from, I think it was
Oh yes,
Pacer.
that's yes, that is huge. Thank you for reminding me of that, 'cause I want to show this on screen for the audience, for the viewing and listening audience. I do want to read this just so this is a minute order in chambers, from May 10th, 2016. It's entry number 387. Motion order in chambers of the Honorable Chief Judge Gloria M. Navarro as to Cliven Bundy, Ryan C. Bundy, Ammon E. Bundy, Ryan W. Payne, Peter Santilli, Melvin Bundy, David Bundy, Brian Cavalier, Blaine Cooper, Gerald A. DeLemus, Eric Parker, Scott Drexler, Richard Lovelian, Stephen Stewart, Todd Engel, Gregory Burleson, Joseph D O'Shaughnessy, Micah McGuire, Jason D. Woods, on 5/10/2016 by Deputy Clerk Aaron Blazevich. And this is the important part, so pay attention. The court is in receipt of various documents from an entity entitled the Unified United States Common Law Grand Jury, seeking to have the court file on this docket its papers regarding the proceedings in this case. However, as this entity is not a party to this case, the documents shall not be filed on the docket. Should this entity wish to open its own case in this court, it is recommended the entity follow the procedures in the Federal Rules of Civil Procedure for initiation of a case. And that concludes that minute order. But thank you for bringing that to my attention. I meant to bring that up earlier. But yes, that is so. This is firsthand proof that the document, like the documents they file. I think Maggie actually referred to this in one of the, I think it was in the last interview you were in. That these people don't actually claim to be fake judges. They don't like they're not the judges that you'd see in the courtroom or something like that. But they're more so just paper pushers. And if that's the case, and their documents are denied by courts, I mean this is they don't provide this transparency. So it's good that we're able to obtain this. But I mean, This is firsthand proof. The documents they file in courts, like at least in regards to this one case, and I would even extrapolate that out farther, but we don't have any evidence of that. Their paper pushing isn't accepted in a court. So, I mean, where do we go with this, Kyle?
Well, mainly, well, that what you read, I think it's directly from Pacer, like their docket or whatever.
Yes,
So
correct.
that's straight from the federal government, folks. Think about that for a moment. The big bad evil New World Order federal government is more transparent than the sovereign citizens are. Think about that for a moment. The big bad federal government is more transparent than the sovereign citizens. Now, just to be clear on one detail, could you read the name of that entity one more time and then give the acronym?
Yes, I can. I'd be happy to, Kyle. Unified United States Common Law Grand Jury. So it's UUSCLGJ.
Yeah,
Hold on, one more time. UUSCLGJ.
LGBTQ, anybody?
Yeah, and then the whatever. There's like I think this one only loses to the long social justice acronym by like one or two. So like this is really bad.
Now, if I remember correctly, that particular I'll use the federal government's term, that particular entity I think is associated with NLA, not the COSA's fake judges. And if somebody
Correct.
would like to correct me on that, please do. But the fact of the matter is that the federal government has given us something actually more solid than the sovereign citizens have, whether they be of the one faction or the other. And that's kind of quite ironic, isn't it?
Oh yes, it's very, very intriguing. Yep, you know when your organization claims to be trying to fight for liberty, but the government that you oppose, or the corporation, so that myth, whatever they want to call it, yeah, that's a problem if that entity is more transparent than yours that is supposed to be fighting for freedom and liberty. So, there was one other thing you kind of mentioned to me in private conversation. There the three factions at play here. So why don't you go into that a little bit here?
Sure, speaking of factions, I think what can be learned from, I think I probably will call it the fake judge or sovereign citizen controversy of 2016 or some such title, maybe somebody can think of a better title later, is that there really were three factions at play here. So the first faction would be the CUSA, and that's where the fake judges come from. That continental small u, capital N, United States of America. So that's your first faction. So that's Gary Darby, Bruce Doucette, and Anna von Reitz, among others who are part of that. The second faction would be the National Liberty Alliance. That's John Duresh and his sycophants. And then, of course, probably the most underrated of the three factions would be, well, that would be us in the alternative media. And more specifically, that would be Alex Ansary, actually Monograph too, because he did the Continental Breakfast with Judge Derby video, and there
Yep,
was a
yep.
heated thing between him and Professor Doom, who of course was basically bootlicking Judge Derby. So another one of the fake judges. Alex Ansary, Monograph, myself, Maggie, you. The five of us kind of comprise that faction of the alternative media where we're noticing the other two factions and we're trying to report on it. We're trying to provide transparency because the other two won't. And we're also trying to see in our faction, trying to look and see like what does this have to do with like the larger picture? And then when the thing happened in Costilla County last year, when Alex was there, when Bruce Doucette was breaking up the Homesteader group, and then when I later was following up about the fake judges and how they were doing their crap in Harney County and trying to mess with the Committee of Safety and so forth, when certain facts came to life, there were some concerns coming from our faction. And the fact of the matter is that there was intellectual dishonesty coming from the other two factions when our faction was reporting on it, on their
Indeed.
activities, because they weren't transparent about it themselves.
Indeed. Indeed. I think it's all, and we mentioned this already, but just for reiteration, just the scope of the intellectual dishonesty here, and also the I guess straw man misrepresenting positions. I mean, yeah, Kyle, you were accused of by Anna von Reitz of being a sycophant of Duresh, which is not true in the least sense. So there's just so much intellectual dishonesty going around. That it's honestly, I mean, I've been aware of these people for a while, and I know they aren't very good at researching. Either they're not very good at researching, or they interpret things. It's confirmation bias. They interpret things to go along with their agenda. I don't know which one it is, but I've known that for a while. But just the sheer scope of this intellectual dishonesty is it was actually kind of surprising. Like I thought we would actually get get something more out of like for the fake judges, especially like just a moderated debate. But people don't really like debating anymore. If it was even a thing in the alternative media, it's kind of unfortunate.
Well, I think the main problem here is that the fake judges and NLA both, yeah, those two factions, they don't want to have any sort of dialogue with our faction at all. Even if, our faction was more neutral, because it originally started that way, and then obviously, there are certain conclusions that some of us have come to. Alex has come to his conclusions. Maggie is, I guess, somewhat neutral. I don't know, I guess somebody would have to ask her. Monograph, of course, doesn't like COSA at all, and then you and I have come to our conclusions as we're doing tonight. And so, I mean, that's just kind of what it is. I mean, if people want to critique our concerns and all that, they're more than free to, and I would encourage that. But the fact of the matter is that there's a history now that we're documenting as it happens in real time, and it's not painting a pretty picture. In fact, if anything, if it's confirming what I wrote about originally in the Disingenuous Activist article, where I almost kind of predicted all of this, because I noticed it happening right at the beginning. And now that it's played out, it's like, yeah, I'm sorry, I really do think there is such a thing as a disingenuous activist, and I think the fake judges and Duresh both are all disingenuous, as far as I'm concerned.
Indeed, indeed, and obviously, yes. Like I mean, obviously, you and I are both open to criticism. That's why we have comment sections on our blogs. Unlike Anna von Reitz, you can't respond to her articles. They're in PDF format without a place to actually post comments. You can respond to us, and you can refute the things that we say. But what I would ask, and this will kind of be the test to see if these people actually listen to this entire thing, before bashing us again as they've done in the past, in the past 20 days or so. Listen to this entire thing. Read the information that we provided. Kyle is only on paper anthology. No, not an anthology. Is only on paper primer on refuting the ideology. tinyurl.com/onlyonpaper. Look at his fake judges article, which kind of set all this off. And Kyle, that is tinyurl.com/fake judges. Correct?
Correct.
Okay. And then also look at. The next one in that little scheme of things would be my article on the NLA, tinyurl.com/ndnla, and hold a, give us the same respect we provided you as far as looking into your ideology and your organizations. Provide us with that same respect, and actually look into the work that we put forward and refute what we say, refute our words, refute our ideas. Don't bash us personally. That's that I wanted to put that in there as kind of a test. I don't think it's going to prevent anything, Kyle, but I might as well go ahead and put it on the record.
Yeah, and I'm glad you did. They don't value freedom of speech, and quite frankly, as far as I'm concerned, those two factions, the NLA and the COSA and their fake judges, I find them to be incredibly arrogant. And that has been really kind of a recurring theme over these past 2 weeks.
Indeed, yeah, I definitely would not disagree in the least sense. And yeah, you are correct. I really don't think they value free speech in any sense. And this is especially in regards to the NLA with my experience with them. They were made aware of their inaccuracies. I made it very, very clear to them. And within their I guess within their responses, there were no refutations. It was sort of just like, well, you're hurting the movement. Like anyone who's talking about community safety is doing a good thing. Like why can't you just like not be a dick about it? And it's like, well, it's because they're inaccuracies. That's not actually what a COS is. They're tossing in their the stuff that they want, the stuff that's in their agenda. They're adding on to that. So,
Yeah, like
yeah,
with the
that's
county, like with the county sheriffs, which has nothing
yes,
to do, right.
exactly. But so rather than correcting those inaccuracies that have been pointed out to them, rather they tried to intimidate me to take down the article.
And you know what? That reminds me exactly what happened 3 years ago when the Free State Project Board of Trustees tried to do that against Chris Cantwell. And that's a point of history now. And I was one of the few people who defended Cantwell at the time that happened back in 2013. And then you fast forward 3 years later, and I would suggest you're in a or were in a similar position, except of course for the one significant fact that, well, Chris Cantwell was a member of the Free State Project at that time, and that's what happened to his that is what led to his ostracism. In your case, you're not even a member of the NLA.
Nope,
So
and I
what hold would they have over you? I mean, if anything, you're more independent of them than Cantwell was of the FSP.
Yeah, that is definitely true, and I pointed this out. I don't remember where I pointed. It might have been in a response comment, or somewhere on Facebook, or in one of the articles. I don't remember where it came from, but excuse me. But I mean, I've had false things said about me before, like in comments and such. Like hell, the last LUA Radio Special Edition we did, Kyle was essentially refuting the things that were said against us. We didn't ask them to take down their posts or anything like that, because they were fallacious. We came on the record, we refuted them, and we moved on.
Right.
What's different about this is that the NLA did not try to refute what I said. Rather, they said, "This is full of misinformation and inaccuracies. Can we please work this out," or something like that. And it's
And
like,
take it down, and take it, and we
well, yeah.
want you to take it down.
Yes, exactly. And it's like, okay, so I mean, you say there's misinformation. Can you point that out to me, please? Because if I'm wrong, if I'm wrong and I made a mistake, I will come out and then say that I did. But the problem, or one thing I keep seeing arise, but with this is, no one points out where I was wrong about. They just say that I was wrong, and then they demand that I take it down. And like I said, whenever fallacious things are said against me or against you, Kyle, we just come out on the record and refute them, and we don't ask them to take it down.
Yeah, that's the
So,
free market. Yeah, that's the free market way for dealing with this kind of thing.
yeah, exactly. So that was another thing that kind of, I don't know. It's very, very obvious. If the NLA that kind of shows me, if they wanted me to remove the article, they were worried about it. At least the members, at least the membership. I don't know about the leadership in general, because they haven't given me a damn minute of their time. But yeah, nonetheless. So I guess, do you want to kind of talk about the goals of these two organizations and how they're a little bit different?
Yeah, I think they're noticeably different. When I was listening to that May 12th, I think it was on May 12th, the so-called emergency COS meeting that Duresh had, he was constantly asking for money, like I said earlier. And as far as I can tell, the NLA is like his own personal kitty fund, his own baby. And
Oh, actually, on that note, do they make their financial records transparent?
of
Like, do
course, of course not.
Oh man, of course.
Yeah, and I could say that about a lot of other, so-called activist organizations, but probably a discussion for another time, although you did have me on to discuss the Activist Legal Defense Fund scam last year
Correct, yeah.
on LUA Radio. So that I think is kind of in the bag. But yes, you're right. There is no financial transparency with any of this crap, too. I mean, that's
Well,
just adding on another layer.
there's no transparency in general. Yeah,
There's no
go
transparent,
ahead though. Yeah.
right. So whether we're talking the court documents, whether we're talking maybe some court footage, or whether we're talking about the financial books, there's no way to know what they're doing. And anytime there is even the slightest bit of transparency, like when John Duresh has his conference calls, it's very much money grubbing. There is an agenda, and if you care about the guilt tripping is constant.
Yep.
Constant. If you don't do what I say, what we say, board of directors or whatever the hell they're calling themselves this week, then you don't care about freedom, basically. You don't care about liberty, because that's the LNR stupid three-letter acronym. And so basically, look, I have no reason to believe John Duresh cares about the Committee of Safety concept, and I think he's using it as a way of engaging in fundraising and otherwise pushing his agenda for basically bootlicking the county sheriffs, quite frankly.
Yeah, I would definitely agree. And there's also another point that's kind of going around in my mind here. I mean, the fake judges are more concerned with their reputation than NLA is. And let me kind of extrapolate that out. They actually, I mean, Anna Von Wright's had a few smear articles against you. Or she tried to smear your reputation. Obviously, you couldn't refute it at all. There's no debate. But they actually responded to your article. on the other hand, the NLA didn't. As far as right now, like I would be very, very happy if they released a press release or something along those lines, or if they took down that PowerPoint presentation, whatever it is. But to this point, they have not done anything. So there has been no response to the email sent to the NLA leadership, and there's just been nothing. There's been nothing. So the fake judge is definitely more concerned with the reputation.
Yeah. And, you know, Anna Vaughn writes, you know, I actually republished her diatribes against me on my own blog because I think transparency is important, at least when, you know, she's spewing stuff. And also there's also a YouTuber, I think by the handle of Gary Larrabee, he's kind of an older gentleman. He was reading her stuff verbatim. So now she's getting, you know, audible versions of her articles out there too, and yep, he's already done at least one or two of the ones that were against me. Yeah. So, you know, it's just kind of like, I don't know what to say anymore. Like, Anna Vaughn writes thinks I'm part of Duresh's faction when I'm not, and obviously if she were listening to this particular special edition, maybe she can get it through her thick skull that I don't approve. Or, well, that's not a bad way of verb. I don't particularly care for the citizens grand jury thing because it's a stupid idea that doesn't work. So, yeah, put that in your cap and smoke it or whatever.
Yeah.
But, yeah, I think what you're seeing with both of these factions, CUSA and NLA, is that they're attempting to co-opt the entire Patriot movement, Shane. You know, the NLA specifically, they're subverting the COS concept, as you've written about. And CUSA and their fake judges are, I guess the best way of putting it is propagating false hopes when they promote the United States corporation myth, uniform misunderstandings about the Uniform Commercial Code, and other versions of the mythology. To mention Anna Vaughn writes briefly one more time, I think she seems to believe in that America is still a British colony, which is a different Patriot mythology. So as you can see, it's just one incorrect misinformation, disinformation thing one more time. And then she has the gall to say that I'm spreading, quote, disinfo garbage, close quote. You know, it's just kind of like, really, lady? And where were you during the catalog rustling? That's what I'd like to know. You know, the funny thing is that a different fake judge was wondering, like, what's my background and all. It's like, well, geez, really? Have you looked at the archive list on my blog? It goes back to January of 2012.
Yeah, that's definitely a pretty good archive. And I wanted to mention this too. The fake judges, I guess we'll just go the sovereign citizens in general, refer to my note in the NLA article for the use of this term. But the sovereign citizens in general, they're much like higher level indoctrination college in one sense, is that they turn the trivia method on its head.
Yeah.
They're coming up with these fallacious conclusions. I think they might actually be starting with the conclusions and trying to find information to verify that, and whether it's
that's confirmation bias.
It is. Yes. Exactly. So, yeah, they would. It would behoove them to learn about the trivia method. Go to Liberty or go to fprnradio.com/LibertyUnderAttack. Man, actually, no, because it doesn't actually say the actual broadcast topic there. Go to LibertyUnderAttack.com and search Daryl Becker, and you'll find a really good explanation of the trivia method. Start applying that. It would definitely do you good.
Yeah.
So I guess Kyle, you want to kind of get into some of the things that we can learn from these two parallel events that have been happening.
I would say the very first one is nobody should place any faith in Patriot mythology whatsoever. You know, Gary Hunt and I did a podcast series a while back, which was appropriately titled Patriot Mythology. And that can be located at tinyurl.com/patriotmythology, tinyurl.com/patriotmythology. And we go through exhaustive detail. We actually go down the list of all of the original source documents that are used to promote whether it's corporate United States or America is a British colony because of the Vatican, apparently. That's what Anna Vaughn Wright talks about a lot. She also has other articles of where she's allegedly addressing Pope Francis or whatever the hell. And so Gary and I went through the original source documents, and the original source documents say the exact opposite of what – the sovereign citizens are claim, or just the mythologists more generally are claiming they say.
And actually, I think it was, I saw someone reference this today, the Clearfield Doctrine. That was when I was a sovereign citizen, that was something that was heavily propagated. And that actually, that was the document. I couldn't remember what it was called when we were talking about it a couple of nights ago, but that is the one that we actually went line by line through to tr and to try to see what, like, how this relates to, like, corporate United States. And this was back in June or July of last year, in 2015. But we went through the entire thing, and like they took it out of context, they added their own interpretation of it, and it was garbage. It was garbage. And I had that on the old LUA website, when it was hosted at a different location. I had that linked on there with, although of course I didn't have the actual decision on there. I had the sovereign citizen one or two page document saying like what it means. So I think that's very, very prominent within this within the sovereign citizen movement as we're kind of discussing.
And you know, I think the next thing to kind of learn is that it's really important to be skeptical, to ask questions. And if these individuals or so-called organizations are not forthcoming, then I think there's that phrase, I think it's from South Park, you're probably gonna have a bad time.
Yep.
So I guess the next thing would also be kind of on that same vein is really demand proof. You know, if they're not being transparent about the efficacy of their methods, then chances are, I would suggest that people really think twice, maybe even three or four times, about hitching up their wagon to theirs.
Yeah, that is definitely true. And obviously for the sake of private commerce, for the sake of obviously for the sake of privacy, I will say this, and I'm pretty sure I'm okay saying this. The person that emailed me about removing their member or removing their membership from NLA, yeah, he had a lot of unanswered questions. So I think that's gonna be pretty prominent, if you're in one of these organizations. Just kind of add that in there real quick.
Yeah, that's and I think that's ultimately what's going to help our faction and you know the alternative media and people that support us, at least in one sense or another, is because our questions are not getting answered. In fact, getting routinely ignored, the ad hominem smear jobs and whatever else. And I think the audience, or at least enough of them, are kind of smart enough to kind of figure out that, hey, you know, even if I'm not 100% correct in my critiques of the sovereign citizen ideology, there's got to be, you know, there's got to be something there. Also, one other thing too, and this was something Alex Ansary brought up more in the context of Castilla County, but I think it can be extrapolated to these so-called activist organizations of really any kind, not just the ones we're talking about this evening, is really the importance of vetting. You know, if people aren't vetted, they're going to be the ones promoting false hopes, whether it's, well, what Bruce Doucette did. I mean, just to revisit Castilla County one more time, Bruce Doucette, and this also came from straight from Roger Marsh, was that Bruce, you know, the judge, a government judge, which wasn't a government judge, it was a fake judge, but a judge is going to come down here to Castilla County with U.S. Marshals to help defend you off-grid homesteaders from the corrupt Castilla County government. That was the claim that Roger Marsh was making. And I don't think Bruce Doucette ever disagreed with that or has said, no, Roger Marsh was wrong. I don't think so. I think Bruce Doucette was on board with Operation Patriot Rally Point, which is what that so-called organization was doing and was successful in destroying the solidarity or unity, if you prefer, of the pre-existing you know, patriot or liberty group that was already there.
Yeah, definitely, definitely. And also to go back to the registry, I'll bring that up on screen again, just for the edification of the audience. But I mean, vetting, like the vetting of the COS registry is extremely important, because there's no way to actually know if these people had public meetings, if they're actually following the process as it is as is supposed to go. There's no vetting on this whatsoever, and I think it's actually even gotten worse, because the last time I put through this Illinois Fayette John, That one actually, like, it wasn't put up immediately. Like, it was noticed after like an hour that it went up. Like, I think for like the first 10 or 15 minutes, refresh it every couple of minutes.
It
and it was not up there yet.
It wasn't instant, yeah.
Exactly. So, that one, like, I've raised concerns in my article. Like, did this even go through a real person? Now I have my answer with the one I just put in when we were doing this show. Illinois Johnson County, Bill. That's me.
And so
yeah, there's no vetting whatsoever, and it makes the whole committee of safety thing look like a fucking joke, and that's a problem.
Yeah, it is a problem because now they're stepping on direct action with all of their, you know, reformism, like with the county sheriff and all that. And so
exactly,
that's so back when you and I were getting interviewed by Louis B of Crotchot Radio about the status turf war. You know, that's mm-hmm. why I kind of mentioned that, you know, arguably there might be a new concept. I might even need to write about it at some point. You know, reformism plus, where you have people mixing in methods of working inside the system in order to change the system from within, and mixing, or the political means of making money, as Albert J. Nock would put it, and mixing that with the economic means of making money, or otherwise taking actions that are, you know, peaceful and voluntary for the most part, in your own life, with either alone or with, you know, people and other people in like fluid peer-to-peer relationships, mm-hmm. and try to collaborate as much as possible, whether it's like gardening or using cryptocurrencies, or, you know, pick an activity, it doesn't matter. I mean, there's over 90 different things that's mentioned in the Freedom Umbrella of Direct Action, that FUDA that you and I put together. So the problem is that if you're doing direct action, that's certainly a good thing. You know, that's what you and I do, Shane, as well as others in the alternative media. But the problem, whether it was the guys at the Refuge, the Citizens for Constitutional Freedom, or C4CF, whether it's those guys or whether it's the guys at NLA, they're mixing working within the system with actually working outside of the system to try and increase one's liberty. And that reformism plus is a dangerous thing, because committees of safety are a form of direct action. Mm-hmm. But then dealing with the county sheriffs at all, that's part of the whole constitutional sheriff-ing thing, which is, I think, is reformist.
You're begging that, it depends on how you want to look at it, but you're either begging the sheriff or you're demanding the sheriff, as is some of these documents on the COS page. Yeah, you demand the sheriff. This is your constitutional duty. If you ignore this, then you're in violation of such and such code or something, whether it's demanding or whether it's
it's
begging.
But hold on, if they're demanding, does that mean that if the sheriff doesn't comply, remember that's one of law enforcement's most favorite words is comply, meaning obey is what they really mean. But yeah, if the sheriff doesn't comply, does that mean you get to slap the cuffs on him and throw him in your own jails?
I wouldn't recommend it.
But no, what I'm just saying as more of a strategic and tactical question, like how are they going to make this happen? Seriously. But you see, nobody actually want, or not any of these sovereign citizen douchebags are actually serious about tactics and strategy. They're not. They're just not. And I hope that comes, if nothing else comes across to people with what we're trying to kind of, you know, wrap up here, what's been kind of going on for about 2 weeks now, is really this. You have to, if you care about freedom, you should really seriously examine strategy and tactics and gauge the effectiveness of whatever you're doing. And do it in a fair and balanced way as much as possible. You know, if there's some good and there's some bad, okay, evaluate that. You know, maybe what works for guy A will not work for guy B, because it's more like a personal choice thing or a difference in lifestyle or personal circumstances or something like that. But if there is something where it's like universally negative, or it's universally positive, or maybe even some shade of gray, that needs to be, you know, mentioned and evaluated too. But the problem is that if there's no transparency about any of it, then it's like, okay, then what are we doing in the alternative media? We're just going to gripe about the latest grievance of the week? I mean, come on.
Yeah. Yeah, that's definitely true. That's definitely true. And I guess the final thing I kind of toss in there to add on to what you were saying is, go to committee.org. That's COMMITTE.org, and learn about the original intent of the COS. I promise you won't find anything about county sheriffs over there. And you can actually find you can find them at COS too. That's another aspect though. Let me check this real quick. Did they remove? Let's see.
Are you talking about
No.
when they like copied Gary Hunt's documents, but
Yes.
they didn't attribute it to him?
Yes. So yeah. So
Oh.
there's documents on there that are from committee.org, but they picked and choose which ones they wanted to put up there.
Yeah, so
Under yeah.
basically.
Okay. Yep. They're, they okay. Those ones are still up there. So yeah. They kind of picked and choose between the documents that they wanted to put up. Didn't attribute Gary on the main page, and yeah. And yeah. That's basically it. Yeah. Go to committee.org and learn about the real intent. Find all of the documents. There's a ton of stuff there. So yeah, definitely committee.org. Let's name it one more time. Committee.org. Go ahead, Kyle.
Well, just to kind of add on to that before we start kind of wrapping up here, is mainly that, there's nothing wrong with copying at all. There's nothing wrong with copying. The problem here, at least with what you were just kind of mentioning, is that not attributing something, a work to the original creator is plagiarism. And plagiarism is a form of fraud, has nothing to do with so-called intellectual property. So, yeah, NLA, there's a question here about is the NLA plagiarizing the works from committee.org? I think an argument could be made, but of course, I mean, this is just so unfair on their part that it's like, where do you start? I mean, they're money grubbing, they're probably plagiarizing, they're trying to silence bloggers like yourself. I mean, the NLA is a piece of crap. I mean, they're like we might as well be talking about the Free State Project or the Anti-Libertarian Party or pick any of these activist organizations, especially the nationwide ones.
Yes,
There's
yes.
nothing good about it. I mean, in previous other articles, and I'll just mention this very briefly in passing, I don't like the Oath Keepers. I don't like any of the Three Percenters, any of these so-called activist organizations, because there's some deeply inherent problems with a lot of them. I don't even like the 10th Amendment Center, because there's some deep problems that I've written about at length. I think probably the one article I will mention, at least for reference here, is the one that was entitled Sifting the Wheat from the Chaff, The Value of Skepticism. And, I mean, like, if you go and join the 3%ers, I mean, there is no such thing as the 3%. I mean, that is a flat-out lie. It's a misunderstanding of something John Adams said, and I'll just keep it to there for now. But yeah, I mean, if anyone joins up with these national level organizations, you're gonna have a bad time. I mean, they backstab
Yep.
their own people. In fact, there's actually that quote by Barry Reid from that book he wrote, which I think you had
Yes,
in your NL.
I could read that real quick if you want me to.
Please, I think that he sums it up a lot more nicely in a shorter time than I can.
Okay, so Barry Reid, quote, "Avoid membership in political groups or other civic organizations. As a rule, these groups are filled with super sneaky, nosy individuals, more willing than not to stab someone in the back if it suits their selfish purposes. Total snakes," end quote.
Yeah, and they are total snakes. I mean, and Barry Reid said that, years and years and years and years ago. And it's like, wow, like he saw it back then. So yeah, that is the problem. Don't join. I mean, if you want to work with people, fine. Leaderless resistance is the way to go, at least I think so.
Yeah, that is that is definitely true, and something I mentioned in the article, and I just want to mention it real quick in passing, is the top down organization of, like, the top down organization of NLA. I mean, they're setting up. I mean, they've got their. Let me get back to the page here. I highlighted it because it's one of the worst points on there. COS committee chairman and national coordinator, Robert. Committee safety are local. They are local. They are created locally. There is no central planning involved in creating a committee of safety. But that is what the National Liberty Alliance is trying to do. They're trying to centrally plan the formation of committees of safety. So that's another thing. The NLA organization itself is totally the antithesis to the actual, I guess, concept of the committee of safety concept. So,
Well, yeah, and you're right. They are central planners. They're not allowing the market to, or at least they're trying to hamper it, the spontaneous order of the free market. And the committee of safety concept is arguably more in line with spontaneous order than it is with central planning. The problem with these national level activist organizations, and they can claim they're against the New World Order, they can claim they're against tyranny, but in all honesty, they are centrally planning things. They're central planners. I mean, can people just call a spade for what it is?
Yep, and I'll bring one other thing into this to kind of verify that point. And there's one thing that's really important in this, and this is posted on Facebook. Obviously, this person does not care about privacy, so we're not breaching that by showing this on screen. This is a screenshot of a status post, but this is just an NLA update on committees of safety. I'll put these in the description. We're about to hit 2 hours here, so I want to move forward. I'll put these in here so you guys can read them yourselves. But the second one is the worst part here. Let's see. It has been commanded that every county in the USA have its own committee of safety website set up and running in 7 days, patterned from a template. So it is demanded. There is no voluntarism in here. This is you must form a committee of safety in your county.
That sounds authoritarian to me.
Yeah, that's
not
that's
cool.
That's really 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 bad. And this is, and I want to emphasize this too. I know we're getting close to 2 hours, but they're completely subverting the committee of safety concept, and they have and I know who this gentleman is, the one in that screenshot, and he's never talked about committees of safety before. He has no idea what they are. He'd rather talk about the Vatican and the UCC and the United States Corporation, all that stuff. So I don't know, Kyle. I'm struggling to find the words here to describe this because the frustration. I'm getting frustrated.
They're immersed in patriot mythology, and this is just the fleshing out of it. This is just the playing out of what happens when you believe in patriot mythology. You come across as a douchebag. So yes, the sovereign citizens are still douchebags. Still douchebags. That has not changed. You know, I mean, we've tried to, and like was said before, reiterate this one more time. You know, there have been attempts by our faction called the alternative media to extend the olive branch and to really kind of reach out to these folks, and they just don't give a flying fuck about us at all. That is just what it is. So it really kind of begs the question, where do their loyalties really lie? I mean, you look at their characteristics, they're claiming they're sovereigns, they're claiming they're rulers. They want to centrally plan committees of safety. They want their money grubbing, or in the case of the fake judges, they want to basically kind of parade around like they're part of some carnival, like a bunch of clowns, which is what they really are. And now they're having this retreat, this summit thing that nobody can get to, and nobody, you know, you can't get any record of the proceedings there, and like nobody knew about this ahead of time. And now it's already 3/4 over with. I mean, what is this shit? Do they really, yep. Do the fake judges really believe that they're going to form their own Bilderberg group? Seriously, think about this, people.
Yeah, that is a good point. That is definitely a good point. And this is kind of the final, and this is something I realized. The NLA is presenting the committee safety concept. I mean, look at the title of the page. Committees of Safety Will Save America. They're presenting as like the committee of safety being that the silver bullet solution that we talked about earlier, and they've obviously never read Gary Hunt's A Plan for Restoration of Constitutional Republic, but yeah, they're presenting this as like the end all be all solution, and that's not how Gary presented it.
No, in fact, actually, now it is true that the Plan for the Restoration of Constitutional Government, which was published in 2012, so that's 4 years old now, that grand strategy that he codified, really. It is true, at least I think it's true, that committees of safety are the linchpin for making that plan, that grand strategy happen. That is true.
Mm-hmm.
But there's other things that are happening in order to make that grand strategy work. And Gary was very clear about that, too. So, you know, and look, guys, if people want to form their own grand strategies and be serious about it and put pen to paper or even critique Gary's plan with their own proposed grand strategy, I mean, I would assume he's more than open to that. The problem is nobody wants to do it because none of these people are fucking serious. They're just not. So I would suggest this to the listener just in terms of at least my closing thoughts.
Okay.
Look at what people are saying. Look at what people are writing. Look at how they act. Look how they treat other people. And then, yes, look at their content and try and make sense of it. And then, you know, make up your own damn mind. I mean, I'm not, you know, I was accused by James Babb in that one informal debate that I took part in about jury nullification, I was accused of issuing orders when I was simply offering suggestions about what other alternatives people can have for spreading the good word about jury nullification, at least in an educational context. Yeah. You know, it's just, look, there's disingenuous people all around, whether they're wannabe politicians like James Babb, or they're fake judges like Darby Doucette and Vaughn Wright, or they're money-grubbing whatever the hell, like John Duresh. There is such a thing as a disingenuous activist. And so, you know, as people go on their journeys through this life, just because somebody claims that they're an activist does not mean they're a good person who wants to change the world for the better. Really, really scrutinize their actions. Really, and who knows? I mean, maybe you'll find an activist who actually does some good and maybe support those people if you feel that your conscience and your heart dictates to you that you should. But I would also say there's also some con artistry. There's some legal defense fund scams. There's some pretty nasty stuff I'm aware of that I've written about. And so, you know, kind of take the good with the bad and make your decisions accordingly.
Yep. I definitely agree. And I've been accused of issuing orders as well. I posted the Freedom Umbrella of Direct Action, tinyurl.com/freedomumbrella2. I posted on a libertarian personal Facebook page. And I got accused of issuing orders whenever the first paragraph is just a directory. There's no demand here at all. But yeah, that seems to be pretty pertinent within the activist community, I guess you could say. But Kyle, I guess any last things before we start to begin to wrap this up?
Really? I mean, I guess the very, very last thing I'll say for tonight, Shane, at least regarding this, is I hope both the previous special edition you and I did as well as this one, I hope this actually concludes, I guess, what could be called the fake judge controversy of 2016. I mean, you and I covered the status turf war back in January, and in some ways this thing with the fake judges and NLA both, in some ways is kind of a almost like a sequel of sorts, because there are some looser connections to Harney County and such. Yep. But yeah, I mean, I think what really needs to happen from this point onward, and I think this is probably the first time I'm mentioning it publicly, is I think a history of the Patriot movement that is as fair and objective and balanced as possible needs to be written. And, you know, if anyone is interested in helping me writing that, I mean, my email address is on my about page on my blog. You know, feel free to get in contact with me. Hell, you can even use PGP if you really want to. But I honestly think that whether it's like our collaborative article on the Harney County Committees of Safety or even some other stuff I've written, I think ultimately a history of the Patriot movement needs to be written so that people can learn from history and not be doomed to repeat it. Because so far, Patriots seem to be, repeating their history and they seem to be doomed to repeat it. So, and I also think, too, that libertarians and anarchists can also learn from the history of the Patriot movement in terms of what to avoid doing as well in their own efforts, whether it's with establishing dispute resolution organizations, private third-party multi-tiered arbitration, or whatever else. So, and having said that, Shane, thanks for having me on this one.
Not a problem, Kyle. I definitely appreciate having you on. We always have a good discussion. I'm with you. I really hope we're closing the book on this. And although I'm not too hopeful, that's the last thing I'm going to write on the subject. It always tends to come up again. So hopefully, at least it'll descend into the depths for at least a little while, so we can not think about it for at least a little while. So thank you, Kyle, for coming on. And with that said, we certainly hope you enjoyed this LUA Radio special edition. If you did, and appreciate the work and the time we put into what we do, please consider contributing financially to the show. You can make a one-time PayPal donation by using the link paypal.me/LUA radio. Again, that's paypal.me/LUA radio. Or you can go to libertyunderattack.com to sign up for a monthly PayPal contribution or for other ways to support us. Make sure to find us on Patreon as well. It's tinyurl.com/LUA Patreon. Again, tinyurl.com/LUA Patreon. And you can get rewarded for your support of LUA. And again, I'll mention this one more time. Starting June 5th, LUA Radio will be live 2 times a week, Sundays and Thursdays from 7 to 9 p.m. Central Standard Time. And we'll also be joined by a new co-host, Jason Paradise. We'll have a little bit of a co-host rotation going on. We'll get you more information on that as it comes out. There will be no show. Actually, I'll kind of refrain from that. That was from the Sunday show. But make sure to check out the website, libertyunderattack.com, for all of our new content. Find us on Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, Tumblr, and Google Plus. And as Ludwig von Mises said, liberty is always freedom from the government. And I'll add on there too, and sovereign citizens. But thanks for joining us, and we'll see you Sunday for our live show, 6 p.m. Central Standard Time on the Freedom Phalanx Radio Network. Laissez-faire.